Praise the Lord. How is everyone doing? We are going to continue our study in the book of Matthew, and today we're going to be reading from chapter 3, and I am reading from the King James Bible. I'm going to go ahead and get straight into it. So chapter 3 starts with, "In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea." So I want you guys to understand something. John the Baptist is Jesus' cousin who is 6 months older than Jesus, and he's preaching this one message, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And what that basically means, it's talking about the New Jerusalem here. The kingdom of heaven is going to be established one day here on earth, and that's what he is referring to. So he's saying, repent and be saved before that day comes. "For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight." So again, this prophet has prophesied about John the Baptist, saying that there's going to be a voice that is crying in the wilderness, and his message that he's going to be preaching is, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. So this is the message that John the Baptist has been going around preaching. He's been preaching, repent ye, for the kingdom of the Lord is at hand. And he's also been preaching, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. That's his message. And that's the message that should be preached today. But we have a lot of watered down messages, but I'm not going to speak on that today. But that is the message that we should be preaching in the church today. Repent, repent, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. That should be the message that is being preached in the church today. "And the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey." So it describes what he's wearing here, and it also describes what he ate. "Then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan." So all these people are coming to him and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. So he has a crowd coming to him from Jerusalem, Judea, and all the regions of Jordan. And these people are coming to be baptized by John the Baptist, and they are confessing their sins. Verse 7 says, "But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who had warned you to flee from the wrath to come?" So if you don't know, the Pharisees and the Sadducees were hypocrites. They were religious leaders, but they were what we see in the church today. Their outward appearance was that of very religious. They had a form of godliness, but denied the power thereof, is the best way that I can put it. On the outside, they would look very godly, but the inside, their hearts were far from the Father. They would operate in a spirit of pride. Their outward appearance was much different than what was on the inside. And you know that the Father deals with the heart. So he's telling them, he's calling them here, generation of vipers, which means hypocrites. He's calling them hypocrites, and he's asking them, who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Meaning, what he's telling them is, who has warned you to flee from the coming of Jesus? Because when Jesus come, he's coming to establish order within the church, and it wasn't even a church at this time, within the temple. He is talking about the wrath being Jesus. Jesus is the one who's going to come to establish order, and he's not coming to play games. So when he says wrath to come, Jesus is coming to expose the wickedness that has been going on in the temple through the religious leaders, because the religious leaders has been assigned to the temple to establish order. And John the Baptist is bold enough to confront them about this, and he's saying, you are a generation of hypocrites. Who has warned you to run away from the wrath to come? So he's telling them here that Jesus is coming to bring down the wrath of God, because he's coming to establish order. And then in verse 8 he says, "Bring forth therefore fruit meet for repentance." What John the Baptist is basically telling them there is, bring forth something that is worthy of showing that you are repenting from a heart posture that is pure. Show me by your, not only your outward appearance, but show me that your heart is repenting as well. Don't just come because you see everybody else coming and you want to put on a show because you're the religious leaders in the church. So you want to make it known to man that you are coming for repentance. So you are following, you know, protocol, right? And you are following the law, but come because you really seek out repentance. So John the Baptist here is dealing with the hearts of these individuals, the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He's saying, come with a heart meet for repentance. So verse 9 says, and think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father. He is actually speaking with the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God is speaking and manifesting through him. He's speaking on a level that the Pharisees and the Sadducees never heard of before. This is something different. John the Baptist is moving in something that is new, that they are unfamiliar with. But it is the Spirit of God that has given John the Baptist this utterance to speak in such boldness and to move in the bravery that he's moving in. And he is speaking something here that they are so unfamiliar to. Listen to what he says. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children of unto Abraham. So what John the Baptist is saying here, don't think for one moment that because you are Abraham's descendants that you shall inherit the kingdom of God. He is saying here that God is even able to raise up the stones to be called the children of Abraham. So not because you're a Jew does not mean that the kingdom of heaven is promised unto you. It's those, right, who he says it right here, whose fruits meet for repentance. And we look at that and it's about our heart posture. That's what saves us. It's our heart posture. And our heart posture, which I'll deal with in another video, has to do with a lifestyle of holiness and a lifestyle of godliness. So then we look at verse 10 and it says, and now also the axe is laid unto the roots of the trees. Therefore every tree which bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. So what does that mean? That Jesus is a representation of the axe, and the representation of the trees is us. If you do not bring forth good fruit, the axe, right, is going to cut down the trees from the root. So it's talking about you and I. If we don't bring forth good fruit, the tree, right, shall be cast into fire. And we know what the fruit of the Spirit is because it's mentioned in the book of Galatians. If we do not bring forth good fruit, which also falls under a correct heart posture before the Lord, we are going to be uprooted and cast into fire. That's talking about hell's fire. We go on to verse 11. It says, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. And he's talking about Jesus, right? He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. The Holy Ghost is one of the three parts in the Godhead. It's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And we're seeing that John the Baptist is saying that Jesus is going to baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. So verse 12 goes on to say, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. And I want you guys to understand something here. Wheat and the chaff, they are connected. But we separate the wheat from the chaff, right? Sometimes they hold it and they toss it. And what happens is the wheat and the chaff become separated. And the chaff is the wasteful part. It's not needed. And we keep the wheat. So what he is saying is that with a fan in his hand, he will come and fan the wheat, right? I want you to picture this. He's going to fan the wheat, and the wheat now shall be separated from its chaff. The chaff is the part that we do not keep. We throw that away. It's not of any use. So what he is saying is Jesus is coming with a fan in his hand. It's not a literal fan, but he is coming to separate those who are saved from those who have rejected God. The people who have accepted Christ Jesus, he's going to save them, but the rest are going to go into hell's fire. Jesus is coming with a fan in his hand to basically separate the wheat from the chaff. So the fan, when you fan it, it separates the two. That's what he's saying there. So verse 13 says, then coming Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. So Jesus is coming to John and he wants John to baptize him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? So John is turning around and asking him, I should be baptized by you, but why are you coming for me to baptize you? He knows who Jesus is. He is reverencing Jesus for who Jesus is. He is saying that I have need to be baptized of you. I know that you are the Christ. You should be baptizing me because I know who you are. So Jesus replied unto him, right, in verse 15, saying, right, thus it be so now. So let it be this way for now. But thus becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. So this is what has got to be done to fulfill all righteousness, right? Then he suffered him. So what does that mean? So then he went ahead and did what Jesus asked him to do, which was baptize him. Okay, verse 16 said, and Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were open unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. So as soon as Jesus was baptized, the Spirit of God descended upon him like a dove, right? And lighted upon him. So what does that mean? The baptism of the Holy Ghost just took place there. Jesus was being a representation of what is to come. This is a demonstration of what is to come. When Jesus was baptized, remember, baptism is what? The killing of the flesh. The flesh is sinful. The flesh is due to death. That first birth that we have when we are out of our mother's womb, that first birth, it destines us to death. The second birth that we have, which is the water birth, it is being birthed through the Spirit of God. It is our second birth. It is no longer of flesh, but it is of the Spirit now. And Jesus is showing us that this is a demonstration of what happens when we are baptized through the Spirit. The Spirit of God descended upon him. And this is why it is important to be taught before baptism what you are doing when you go down in that water, that you should be coming up as a new creature, as a new creation, and that your old life has been passed away and your new life has become made new. Now are born through the Spirit of God, and it's no more of the flesh. We are no more of that sinful flesh, but it is now born of the Spirit. And that is a demonstration of what Christ is showing us here, that the Spirit of God descended on him. And we have that today when we die to our flesh, and when we are baptized in the water, the Holy Ghost descends on us. And then verse 7 says, and I love this, and lo, a voice from heaven saying unto him, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. So that flesh had to die so that the Spirit of God can be in full effect here. Okay, and that is what happens when we are baptized. The Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost, becomes, we give permission to the Holy Ghost to have full effect in our life. And we are then taken on our spiritual walk with God. And in that matter, all fleshly desires have to pass away because we are coming into our new walk. We now have a revelation of who Jesus Christ is. And that is why it's so important for us to acknowledge truly what baptism is all about. It's about finding a revelation of what Christ has done for us and how much he loves us. And it's about us coming to an understanding that our lifestyle needs to be different. Because a lot of times we are baptized and we don't fully understand what to expect after that. And that's why we end up with a lot of compromising Christians. Thank you guys so much for watching. I hope that you guys would have taken away something from this teaching. God bless you guys. Until next time. Bye.